I am the...
Your wife went to my ranch last night to demand that Deanna stay away from you.
The Amazons.
Log on to the KBC website at www.kbc.co.ke to get the latest breaking news, entertainment, sports, politics, lifestyle or business trends from Kenya and around the world. Never miss new episodes from your favorite TV shows, reruns and movies. Just stream online or watch live on your YouTube channel at KBC Channel 1 TV shows for the day's biggest stories. Trustworthy news and family entertainment. Log on to KBC Channel 1. Watch what you want anytime, anywhere.
Jasiri kama nyinyi mnogopa kufanya mazamkembe.
Mimi naona natafute maarifa mengine kabla hatujajuta.
Upatie nafasi angalau niambie ukweli, lakini kila kukicha uongo wako azidi kimo tu.
Dawa kwa wapi mzee? Ama ona hapa pakufai.
Well, good morning. Hope you had a lovely weekend and thank you for joining us for today's edition of Sports Check, where, of course, you get to have some sporting conversations as well as have a look at what happened over the weekend. Obviously, over the weekend, we had a lot. We had the Women's CAF Champions League. We had the FKAF Premier League. We also had international leagues. And also here locally, a lot has been happening. Of course, as we all know, the National Olympic Committee of Kenya is set to hold its elections next month. That is December 9, after a long time waiting. We are going to be talking about that, and in studio joining us will be Francis Mutuku, of course, the Secretary General of the National Olympic Committee of Kenya. But before we get to that, let's take you to KICD, where the National AIDS Control Council and the National Population and Development are holding a press, of course, addressing some issues, among them teenage pregnancies in Kenya. Let's listen in.
Attendance interjecting. I can see a hand there. Two, three. Right, so I'll begin from here. Yes, please.
Okay, good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Philip Nyakwana. I work for Movement of Men in City Kenya. That is a main support organization. So I have two or three comments that I would want to make, and I want to begin from what Dr. Ruth left about bringing everybody on board as far as managing teenage pregnancy is concerned. Because what am I seeing that most of the time people talk, and they can say that our biggest challenge is in our strategy on how to maybe address some of these issues. You find that most of the people who are dealing or working around teenage pregnancies, they do a lot of interventions that support teenage girls who are either pregnant or who are given birth. But you hardly find people targeting men or boys who make them pregnant. And when you see them targeted, they're just targeted as perpetrators or those who are accused. When you go forward, they still have some powers and capacity able to make that girl pregnant after going through all those processes. But because maybe they're ignorant, or because society has made them so. So we really need to come up with strategies that addresses the social aspect and also the economic aspect. But this aspect should not only be targeted to girls. Let's also see how do we bring their boys and men on board, and if we really want to have a meaningful impact about this. Another issue that maybe I wanted to comment on was the issues around coordination. Yeah, because and I really want to appreciate NAC and the National Council for the work that they have done. But we might also find ourselves in a situation where maybe tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, we want to find the State Department for Gender Affairs also having a meeting and also talking about teenage pregnancy. We might also find National Gender and Equality Commission also convening and talking about the same thing. How do we bring all our efforts together and have a plan that we can call a Kenyan plan with different key stakeholders that can help us to achieve in addressing some of these issues? Yeah, I think that can help us to move and also to have.
Well, we shall be taking you back there in a while as well as more updates. But for now, let's dig in into the conversation. As I did mention in studio, joining us to talk about the upcoming National Olympic Committee of Kenya elections, as well as the upcoming 2022 Birmingham Commonwealth Games. In studio with us is Secretary General NOC, Francis Mutuku. Thank you very much, Bwana Francis, for giving us the time right here on Sports Check.
Good morning, and thank you. It's my pleasure.
Okay. So now maybe we can get into it, and let's start with this. The current office has been here since 2017, and before we even get into the elections, maybe what can you say should be convincing Kenyans that the current office is ready? Because I do understand that, well, not so many people have announced their candidature, but we both know some of the top figures who will still be vying for the second term, second and last term, according to the Constitution. So maybe what can you say is NOC's biggest, let's say, campaigning tool to convince people that indeed you are ready for a second term, going by the returns of the first term?
Thank you. I think one of the things which has happened, mm-hmm. and I'll talk in very, very general terms, mm-hmm. The current office came through a transformational platform. The background to 2017, as we all know, was not very, very good,
yeah.
in terms of where the National Olympic Committee was placed as a brand, mm-hmm. in terms of what image the National Olympic Committee obtained at that time. And after a lot of constitutional changes, a lot of clamor for change within the sports sector, mm-hmm. Then a new constitution was put in place. And with that new constitution, that brought in a new office. And the new office's biggest challenge was to change the perception of the National Olympic Committee, because that was a big, Rio 2016 scandal and a lot of other challenges within the sports fraternity and within the Olympic family had painted the National Olympic Committee in extremely bad light. And therefore, the biggest challenge and therefore the biggest objective of that office was to change that image. And I believe up to now, 4 years down the line, every Kenyan of goodwill agrees that that has been changed. There were a lot of big engagements. There were basic issues which were challenged, the issuance of kit, as basic as giving a tracksuit, shorts, and all that. That was a challenge. Mm-hmm. Issues of teams traveling and ticketing, accommodation program, those were basic. Preparation of teams before then was not as good as has been in the last 4 years. And most importantly, which is always the biggest objective of the National Olympic Committee, that was the preparation of Olympics. Before, we had a lot of challenges, and I believe within the last 4 years that has been done. We can say that we have been able to transform the National Olympic Committee. We've been able to place it where it can be equal to other National Olympic Committees of the world, not just in Africa, but the world. We've actually become a standard to go by amongst other National Olympic Committees of Africa. We've set up a secretariat which is able to serve our affiliates, to be able to serve our sports people. We've ensured that at least at the center of everything we do, because I think previously that conversation about the athlete and what needs to be done had been lost. We've been able to bring it right at the center. We had two main objectives in the last 4 years. One of them was to build capacity, because once capacity is built, then we can be able to work on very many areas. Capacity in terms of across board, mm-hmm. from the technical officials, from the coaches, administrators, because we know we need to build a strong administrative force to be able to drive the sport to where we need to be. Technical capacity in terms of referees, in terms of coaches, we provided a lot of opportunities of training, of learning to coaches. We've given a lot of opportunities to non-technical people like physiotherapists, nutritionists, and medical doctors. A lot of opportunities have come for them to go and train. That has been capacity building. And then we've run a number of scholarship programs, for athletes who are preparing for the Olympics, teams which are training for Olympics. They were given opportunities to be able to train. We've established an office which is, even during this period where we could say it's an electioneering period, the functions of the National Olympic Committee can still be able to go on. As you are seated here with you, the office is fully functional. Somebody does not have to wait for a particular individual to be served. We've opened it up so that it can be able to serve the not only the Olympic family, but everybody who wants to be served by the National Olympic Committee. Those are some of the activities we've been able to achieve in the last 4 years. We say that we've transformed the National Olympic Committee. Mm-hmm. It's an ongoing process. It's not a one-off or a short period. It's a long term, because once the National Olympic Committee is transformed to be able to build capacity and to be able to deliver services, then the reflection will be on the sports performance in the different international activities.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and now obviously you've explained the reasons behind why the current office, you know, has that right to say that we've done something. And now for the next cycle, obviously, let's say the current office remains, you know, they once again they get a second term and a final term, obviously, in office. What are the main areas that you feel at the moment? Because you've talked about the basics, which you've already laid in place, so already all the strategies and everything. So the implementation bit, what do you think that you could have done better, or you hopeful of doing better if you were to get re-elected for a second term?
If you look at from the way I've laid out, the last 4 years have been to put the structures in place. And we believe the structures are in place. The ship is ready to sail. The National Olympic Committee is able to deliver the services as envisioned across by everybody who wants to see a transformation in sports. I'll just take an example of the recent held Tokyo Olympics. You can see the conversation changed from tickets, from kit, from accommodation to performance. Mm-hmm. I believe that is where now the conversation, that is where the focus can be. Instead of looking around anything which is beside sport, now we focus on the sport per se. We have a big challenge in terms of preparing our sports people for the 2024 Paris Olympics. We have a big challenge for preparing for them. Practically every year there'll be a big event. Next year we have the Birmingham Commonwealth Games in July. The following year in 2023 we have the African Games, and then 2024 will be the Paris Olympics. So every event in the next 3 years gives an opportunity for the National Olympic Committee to be able to prepare all the teams which will be participating in order to participate effectively. A very simple analysis is how many sports can we be able to present in the 2024 Olympics? Just the number of sports which will be behind the Kenyan flag. Mm-hmm. And then secondly, in terms of performance, how many teams can we get to a podium finish? How many medals can we get? Can we improve our medal tally from the last few periods to 2024? Can we, for the first time, to start preparing our team early? We are lucky now these people are focusing on the performance. And while they are the performance, we are telling people that for somebody to go and win a gold medal, it does not come overnight. It's a long-term process. There are some where we are already late in terms of doing it. The others where we are on time right now, if the work starts right now in terms of preparing our teams. Because everybody wants to celebrate when the national anthem is being played, when the Kenyan anthem is being, our national flag is being raised. Mm-hmm. But before that point, we need a lot of work. And that work starts from now. That's one of the priority, I think, would be for the new office. Mm-hmm. But secondly, the capacity building has to go on. Mm-hmm. We've seen in the last few years that there are gaps within the administration levels of our federation. There are gaps in terms of the infrastructure. Mm-hmm. Though that's not a main core business of the National Olympic Committee, but we believe the continuing good working relationship with government can ensure that infrastructure is provided. A lot of our top athletes, especially in what we call the minor sports, you find that they compete within international standards for the first time in a big event. We are saying this a big standard or high-level standard of infrastructure should be availed while people are starting. The second thing is we are also looking at 2026. 2026 will be big for Africa because that will be the Dakar 2026, when the first time the Youth Olympics will be held in Africa. We are saying that's a great place for us to be able to start preparing a new generation of sports people. Before COVID, we had put in place through our Youth Commission a program training for youngsters. We started it off at Kenya, where we invited all federations to nominate their youngsters to start training. Mm-hmm. At that time, we were training them for what was to be 2022 Dakar Olympics. But due to the COVID pandemic, that was postponed to 2026. We now have another opportunity for at least close to 4 years to prepare ourselves. Why that is important, because there has been all this conversation of why are we always dominant in athletics, is because other sports, we need to start them at a very early stage. So as a country, we can say, let's start a new page. Let's get new people, new generation of sports people, and 2026 provide a very, very good platform for us to launch practically all sports in terms of performance. So if as a country, led by the National Olympic Committee, we start preparing youngsters who probably will be 10 years now or 12 years, work with our affiliate federations, start preparing them continually, expose them to international standards so that within the next 4 to 5 years they are ready. By the time they go to Dakar, we'll have a new generation of sports. And we are borrowing. A lot of countries have achieved that. Mm-hmm. A lot of us see how China currently is doing very well. And they did very well because when they had the Olympics in Beijing, they had almost a 12-year program where they got a lot of their youngsters to prepare. And since then, they have been dominant in a number of sports. Same story can happen for Kenya, and we believe that would be a very, very critical aspect, a very big objective for the National Olympic Committee. Mm-hmm. The second one, when I talk of the building of capacity, is coaches. We are saying, yes, there are some sports which will not get an athlete to the big events like mm-hmm. Olympics, but we have a referee who can be good enough to go there. Do we have other technical officials who can be able to go? Because they are still flying the Kenyan flag in the different aspects. Mm-hmm. So the capacity will involve exposure of the different referees. We are saying that we want every federation to move their current referees from level Y to level W or level Z and to the highest level.
And of course, we've seen a couple of federations, getting into that. We have had a lot of workshops really in regards to coaching referees. Coaches too on the same, and we shall. And there are a couple of things we mentioned about the youth center. We shall be looking also at the progress in regards to that and capacity building, incorporating all that you've talked about, the physiotherapists, everyone who can play a role in that. And we shall be talking about that in a minute. But kindly, Mutuku, allow us to digress just for a minute. We shall be heading to KACC over to the workshop. They build by Kenya, build Kenya, of course, encouraging investment in the country, where my colleague Alan Aoko from the business desk is on standby to tell us the latest and, of course, what has been discussed in the meeting. Alan, kindly.
Indeed, as you know, here in Kenya, we are known for a lot of enterprising and innovative solutions, and those come from small businesses, which are estimated to at least give around 84% of total employment in the country. But going forward with the advent of COVID-19, there needs to be a way to move away from the misfortunes that was brought by the pandemic. And going forward, we seek to understand What can be done in terms of policies? What can be done in terms of linking small businesses with the capital that they need to proceed? And just to get a deep dive into this kind of conversation, someone who is always involved with small businesses and employment of the youth, we are privileged to be joined by Mr. Mike Rabah, who is the CEO of Homeboys Entertainment Group. Welcome to our outside broadcasting studios, sir.
Good morning. I'm loving the studios.
Thank you very,
very
much.
Very airy and well lit.
Yes. Thank you very much. So what we want to understand is, how can small businesses continue to thrive as the economy continues to recover?
Okay, I think we must start by first thanking the government opening up the environment for work to now take place fully. Obviously, COVID has been a big challenge to a lot of us, both not just small, but all businesses have actually taken a big hit in terms of commercialization. So the fact that now we're now open for business, of course, within the reason, gives everyone a new chance to now reinvent themselves. So obviously, it's been a huge task and a big challenge for many small businesses to survive this pandemic, especially most of those who have been in the entertainment industry, hospitality industry, those were vastly affected by closure. But I think now that we have been given the green light, it's now time to relook and re-engineer DNA. And people, there's still an element of consumerism that is out there. It's just, how do you repackage yourself, you know, such that you remain relevant for those who survived and those who are actually at the verge of closing? How do you now get a new impetus to get your business up and running? So I think those are conversations we want to start having now, moving forward.
Indeed, that's very interesting. You bring out that businesses had to reinvent themselves to remain in the market. We understand about the Make It Kenya exhibition that's coming soon, an opportunity for small businesses to meet with market players. What does that mean for you, and how will it help small businesses grow?
I think I first must commend the conveners of Make It Kenya. It was a very brave and timely activity that's well required by SMEs in this country. So the essence of Make It Kenya, one, is to showcase those businesses that have survived and have products that can be utilized across by other bigger suppliers, all right? And the fact that they'll be having one central place that can come and convene and sell themselves, hopefully to a bigger audience, not just locally, but also internationally, is one of a good way to kick off the economy.
Thank you very much for speaking to us. Nice and short and brief. But just finally, many companies have been, complaining, maybe the smaller ones, that they still have a challenge of approaching these venture capitalists, that it's very difficult, and their criteria for funding is very difficult as well to comply with. How best can we really make it easier for small businesses to get this kind of capital?
I think, first of all, you have to redefine what a venture capitalist is, especially in the Kenyan context. In the West, they used to big tickets where they can't fund businesses beyond a certain amount of money. But I think in a developing economy like Kenya's, we need people can accept even small tickets, you know, anything from $20,000, not $20 million. So we are coming up with a new format where we'll be able to look at businesses, however small, that need whatever kind of funding, from 5,000 shillings to $1 million, 2 million shillings. So that's a format we're creating, and we will launch this at Make It Kenya. So any business that has an idea and a good concept that needs some kind of support can now easily access funding without too much red tape, you know, where there's, I think, also an audience that understands, or investor that understands what they're going through. I mean, we've been through the same process. We know what it takes to run a business in an environment like this. So having people like us coming in and trying to customize solutions for small businesses, that's, I think, is going to be a huge, huge positive point for this conference.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for speaking to us. Indeed, Munga, we have been speaking with Mike Rabah, who is the CEO of Homeboys Entertainment, and we were just expounding, getting a deep dive on how small businesses can thrive in the country. I don't know about you, Munga, maybe you have that small kiosk you want to grow. I think this is an opportunity for you next week to come and check it out. You might get some funding. Back to you.
Thank you very much, Elena Oko. And indeed, we shall be discussing that later when you get back to the office. And of course, for the viewers, among the issues that Alan's been talking about, amongst other issues really, is about how to get back businesses on track after the challenges that were, you know, witnessed or experienced during the COVID-19 pandemic, which, you know, still continue, not like, you know, the COVID-19 pandemic is over, but the challenge is that, you know, before the country really opened up, unlike now. So discussing strategies on how to get small, medium enterprises back on track. More details to follow in our subsequent bulletins. 1 p.m. You have the Rubini at 7 and, of course, Prime Edition tonight. Now, back to the conversation at hand. We were in studio, of course, with Francis Mutuku, Sec-Gen NOC, talking about what the current office, NOC office, has done that warrants, or rather that gives it that right, for lack of a better word, to ask to serve the country for a second term. And Mutuku, before we digressed for a minute, we were talking about capacity building, talking about structures and everything, and you mentioned something quite interesting that has been, you know, it has been discussed recently in many circles, sports indeed. And you were talking about how you have been training people on how to incorporate, or rather, you know, incorporate their skills in the sport. You don't have to be, you know, an athlete. You don't have to be a swimmer. You mentioned things like, you know, physiotherapy and whatnot, how you've been training people as NOC and whatnot. But what is the attitude towards that at the moment? Because it is a good initiative, but our teams, Kenyan teams really, or federations, are eager to pick that up. Is that something that they are prioritizing at the moment?
Yes, we are very lucky that a lot of federations are right at the forefront. The world of sports has changed drastically. Mm-hmm. There is a big approach to scientific ways. And unlike before, and this is something which a lot of us Kenyans did know, where we used to say one athlete has too many officials, nowadays that's the standard, that around one athlete you have very many people. Mm-hmm. You have a coach, you have a technical official, you have a physiotherapist, you have a strength and conditioning. Right now, especially out of the Tokyo 2020, you also need a psychosocial person to assist, because there are a lot of mental challenges along the athletes. So for us, we are looking at it, one is an attitude change. We need people to start embracing the modern ways of managing sports. Secondly, we also know there is a financial constraint. And our solution to a lot of federations is having technical officials who are in the pool context, like we did for the Olympics. What we did was to provide some technical people. We had for 2 years a strength and conditioning expert who went around working with the different federations, first to impact directly the national team athletes or team players, and more importantly to work with the coaches within the federation so their capacity is built, because it's not a touch and go, it's a touch and build. Mm-hmm. So the strength and conditioning was going to change that aspect, because strength and conditioning has been a big element in terms of our sports. The second areas where we will go to is train those who we can avail to all the federations, especially when you are going for major games. But because of time, we also start developing people. 2 years ago, we had the first ever sports science forum. Mm-hmm. Where we brought all the coaches and we brought all the experts, not from out but from Kenya, who have been able to advance their skills, to advance their knowledge, to come and share with the rest of the coaches. And we believe that this sharing of knowledge across federations, across disciplines, will be able to greatly enhance the capacity of a lot of our technical people in terms of sports development.
Okay. And since you mentioned mental health, of course, we'd like to commend Athletics Kenya, as in a few minutes, really, at 11, they're holding a workshop, really, with athletes talking about or discussing mental health, especially at this period where we have been having a lot of challenges, especially for our young athletes. So be sure to catch that update in our subsequent bulletins too. Now, Mutuku, before the previous elections, we had a couple of issues regarding the electoral process. As you remember, also about the constitution and all that. Even really, we were this close to getting a ban, if you do remember. And we've come a long way to a point whereby, unlike back then, whereby out of the 26 affiliate associations of NOC, we had a lot of challenges with some saying that they're being, you know, intentionally being locked out of the elections back then. So this year, maybe, have those issues been ironed out? Because I do understand that some federations are still in, let's say, those wrangles. They are yet to be solved. And, you know, I'm talking about, I'm sure you know about this, swimming. Then we have golf, Kenya Golf Federation, Kenya Golf Union, questions in regards to which does indeed run sports in the country, with some people also criticizing the sports registrar, Rose Wazike, in her decision to award the Federation certificate instead of KGU, Kenya Golf Union, which allegedly is the one that runs affairs of golf in the country. So where are we with such matters, and with the elections set for the 9th of December? Are we sure that all these issues will have been resolved before then?
Thank you. First, we must say, and as you rightly put, between 2017 to now, the landscape has greatly, greatly changed. Mm-hmm. And the background to a lot of challenges was the transition. As you all know, at least the people who follow sports, before Sports Federation used to be registered under a different act. Mm-hmm. When the Sports Act 2013 came into place, it required the existing Sports Federation then to transit, mm-hmm. To transit under the new act. For different reasons, there were very many challenges in that transition period, and that's what caught up with the elections of the National Olympic Committee that side. Mm-hmm. Never mind, there will always be the bit of the politics, because, I mean, elections are a political aspect, and so every candidate would want to hold on to everything, and the non-transitioning of some of the federations came as an opportune point for a number of candidates to be able to push for that agenda. But since then, we are proud and very happy that a lot of our federations have since regularized mm-hmm. their legal status with the sports registrar. And right now, the three you mentioned, the scenario is a little bit different than what was there before. Mm-hmm. I'll start with the Kenya Golf Union. Mm-hmm. Kenya Golf Union, we stand on two levels. One is Kenya Golf Union, which everybody knows has been running the sports. And then there's Kenya Golf Federation, which has been registered. And now, unfortunately, the legal status have to stand. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the person or the office which holds the certificate, that's the one which is recognized by the Kenyan laws. And right now, there's a mediation going on. And we are very happy that the golf fraternity came together, mm-hmm. discussed, saw the different challenges of, one, the legal basis, and second one, the practical aspect. And they have been in discussion under the tribunal, a led mediation. And I believe they have already set a date for the election under the Kenya Golf Federation, because that's the one which is recognized legally. We believe after that election, now they will not talk of Kenya Golf Union or Kenya Golf Federation. The golf fraternity will be under one umbrella in practice and in law. The second one is Kenya Swimming Federation. Kenya Swimming Federation, in terms of the federation, at least from what we've been advised by the registrar, in terms of the federation's legal status, it is right. What is in question is the officials. And the reason is because they have not had election for some time. Mm-hmm. The tribunal stepped in. The process has taken longer than we'd all have wished. We are hoping that can be easily resolved. But the registrar has custody of the officials who are currently recognized, and we believe she'll be able to advise the electoral board on which people to recognize. The tribunal is also within, the matter is still within the tribunal. They'll also be able to advise. So again, the Kenya Swimming matter is a simple one in terms of moving forward, because we are talking of its leadership and not its legal status, which again is a much better place to be. The only federation which now we can talk of the legal status is Kenya Squash. Mm-hmm. And Kenya Squash, since this discussions of the electioneering process came, they have moved very fast. I believe now they have been able to submit all their documents with the sports registrar. We believe the due process will be carried, hopefully faster than normal, because it's in the interest of the federation to be part and parcel mm-hmm. of the election process of the National Olympic Committee. The executive sitting right currently has decided that it is in the best interest of everybody to be part and parcel of the voting process, mm-hmm. because the people who are elected will serve all the sports between now and 2024. And therefore, if everyone can be able to cast a vote to decide who they'd want to serve them during that period, that would be good. But even over and above that, more importantly, we've encouraged federations to regularize their issues, because it's not just about elections, and they're not election machines. It's about sports. Mm-hmm. It means if they're not right in the legal standing and in the operations, it means then even on a daily basis, sports mm-hmm. cannot be able to go. But we are seeing very good signs, and we believe by 9th, almost 100% status will be achieved, which will be a big thing, not for election, But in terms of sports moving forward, between 2017 and 2021, that will be a complete change in terms of the legal status of federations.
Okay. Fingers crossed that indeed we shall have the election on the 9th of December and, you know, we won't have all this issue cropping up when the time approaches. Now, obviously, we're expecting IEBC to be in charge of the election, but due to the ongoing registration, you know, voter registration exercise for the general elections next year, you had to, of course, change tactic and settle on the Center for Corporate Governance. And you had a few sessions last week as NOC, through last week and in the last month, indeed. So maybe what are some of the few electoral rule changes that we should be aware of heading into the elections?
One of the reasons why we've had a number of meetings in the last 1 or 2 months is because a seat in office and interested parties in running, we wanted to open it up so that it's a consultative and all the federations are made part and parcel. The National Olympic Committee Constitution provides that the executive brings the electoral board or nominates the electoral board and then the Extraordinary General Assembly ratifies. But we changed that and said the federations submit who you feel would be, you'd want to be the electoral body. And we had a number of federations nominate different bodies. And in the first Extraordinary General Assembly, we settled by consensus on IEBC. Unfortunately, like you rightly put, IEBC was not able to take up the time schedule. And this is not even new schedule. It was in compliance with several documents which we've guided them. The first one is the National Olympic Committee Constitution. The second one is the Sports Act. The third one is the Sports Registrar Regulations, because the Sports Registrar regulation have been put in place so that all federations can be able to comply with that program. And of course, we are under the International Olympic Committee, so the IOC charter also becomes very central. And where there is any doubt, then the Kenyan Constitution comes in case there is any of those documents are inconsistent with the Constitution. So the consultative forum was to get a program, an agreeable program, and one of the agreeable program was a new date. Why? Because we have to run back and see what are the milestones which need to be achieved before that particular date. And the consultative forum was able to agree. The electoral body was able to give its program. A lot of over 99% of the items we are all agreed on, and we believe now the ball is rolling towards 9th of September. What are the days we are looking at? 11th of November, as required, will be informing the registrar based on the sports registrar regulations. Mm-hmm. On the 25th, then on the 21st, a notice will go out because we require 21 days notice with all the documents which need to be provided to the affiliates. And then the process will start. People will start sending out their nominations. By 25th, I believe, of November, we should be able to start releasing which people are officially. I know there's a lot of talk of who is running, who is not running, but officially, yeah, from the 25th is when we'll be able to know who is standing for what position. Okay. And then hopefully, without any other issue coming in play, then 9th of December, we'll have the National Olympic Committee election to elect the team which will prepare Kenya for the next Olympics, which will be in 2024.
Okay. Now, as we switch gears to the Commonwealth Games, or rather before we switch gears to the Commonwealth Games preparations, let me ask you, out of the more than 10 positions, 13 positions,
13 positions.
Up for grabs, we have the president, first deputy, second deputy, sec-gen, the one you currently occupy, deputy secretary general, treasurer, all that. Which position will you be running for? I know you've mentioned that on the 25th, by the 25th of November, we'll have a good, a clear picture of who is vying for what position, but Are you keen on, you know, remaining in office? And if so, same position or a different position?
Yes, I'll be offering myself to serve the sports fraternity under the position of the Secretary General. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, at least we got to hear that first right here on Sports Check on KBC. Thank you very much. Let's switch a bit to now the Olympic, today, apologies, not Olympic Games, Commonwealth Games 2022 in Birmingham. We had the Queen's Baton, obviously, tour Kenya of the 72 countries and territories that he's supposed to tour before the Commonwealth Games kick off in Birmingham. And Moving forward, we had the First Lady officially launch the games here in Kenya. So as NOC and the federations, what are our timelines as we, you know, as we prepare for the Commonwealth Games, team selection, all that? What are our timelines currently?
Our timelines are very strict, but allow me to just give a background to the Queen's Baton, which has just come. It was launched on the 7th of October by the Queen. And the reason for having the baton go across the 72 countries and territories is to create awareness. Create awareness about the Commonwealth. Commonwealth is a movement. A lot of people, and I need to mention this, that is not just the former British colonies which are part of the Commonwealth. Mm-hmm. The Commonwealth community has opened up to anyone who wants to apply and wants to be part of it. And an example is just Rwanda, that they applied and they were admitted, so they'll be participating, although they are not a former British colony. So it's a creating of awareness by the baton going from one country to another. When we received it, it had come from Cameroon. After we finished with the creation of awareness in Kenya, it went to Uganda. And from Uganda, I believe by today, it will be going to Rwanda. Mm-hmm. The baton and also as themes which we need to expound and promote. The first one is inclusivity, the second one is sustainability, and the third one is youth. And these are very, very critical, especially when we talk of sustainability. And to celebrate the sustainability aspect of that, we went to the Gong Hills, where a lot of our long-distance athletes train. We went and planted trees. And it was just at the right time because the climate discussions was going on in Scotland. So it sort of went very, very well. We are planting trees on this side, and our president is representing us in the climate discussions. But why Gong and why plant trees? It's because that's where our athletes train, and we want a clean environment. We also have a lot of activities around the where Kenjen as their stations, because we are promoting also clean energy. Mm-hmm. These are aspects which our sports people and through the Commonwealth sports they have to promote. The second one was in terms of the youth. We are saying that the youth need to be included a lot in activities, and one of the things we did was to bring a lot of school going children to come and be part and parcel to carry the torch, to run, to celebrate, because they are the future of our Commonwealth programs, and therefore we need to incorporate. And last but not least is inclusivity. Inclusivity just means we want everybody on board. And like the Olympics, where we have the para games separately, this time for Commonwealth, we are going to have both the all together. And that one very critical aspect of inclusivity. So even as the baton was being taken around, we had people from the para sports also being part and parcel. Inclusivity also is very critical to include young and old. And therefore, just to represent the old people, we had our legendary Kipchoge Keino to come. John Gugi was part of it, just to represent that all ages are part of the Commonwealth program, and a lot of them are going to participate in one way or another as prepare our actual competition, as we go for the actual competition. Now to the Commonwealth itself, we are hopefully going to send, last time when it was held in Gold Coast, we had about 129 athletes representing about 17 different disciplines. Our prayer and our preparation right now is that we can be able to send all the federations which are part and parcel of the program. That would be something like 24 different federations participating, mm-hmm. and all of them can be able to prepare from now. A lot of them, especially netball, has already started going for the qualification. Others are getting direct acceptance. In fact, most of them are getting direct accepted to the Commonwealth. So what it means now, the National Olympic Committee, and this time it will be the Commonwealth Games Association, needs to prepare all these teams. We believe straight after the election, in conjunction with the Ministry of Sports, the steering committee will be put in place, mm-hmm. the central management, so that come January, the team start preparing.
Okay. We're going to be having a lot in the coming weeks, of course, a lot of engagement in regards to the Commonwealth Games, because at least there is a time frame at the moment, an established one, really. But now, as we wind up for the interest of time, still in the Commonwealth Games, it has always been, on the issue of inclusivity, it has been pushing that a lot. I remember in the last Commonwealth Games, they worked at making the medal events for men and women the same level, equal. And this time around, apparently we will have more ladies medal events compared to the men's events. Does that mean, like for Kenya as NOC, does that mean that we're going to be sending a larger ladies contingent than the men's contingent?
We are hoping we can be able to do that. Mm-hmm. Just to remind the viewers that for the Olympics, we had more ladies in the Kenyan team than the men. And then for the Commonwealth, on paper, we should have more ladies because there are some sports where we'll not have the men equivalent. For example, netball.
Yeah.
Netball, although we have the version of men's netball and the women's netball, for now we know it's the women's netball who are in the running. Mm-hmm. So just by that, it means the women have a head start by a number of athletes. If Cricket Kenya had not been banned, it would have also meant that we'd be able to send our women's cricket team. But every other sport, we are going to have both the men's and the women's version, and we are hoping it's also strategic that the women's sport is pushed because there are very, very good chances of doing very well. Mm-hmm. The men's side is normally more competitive, so I'm hoping that our federations can be able to push a lot of the ladies teams to be able to qualify and to participate very well. So we are looking forward, if we achieve an over 50% percentage of women, that would be very good, and it would be just a continuation of the standards which we are set in the Olympics.
Okay. Now, before I give you a chance to convince the viewer why the current office, NOC, should be given another chance to, you know, run the sports in the country in the next 4 years, we're going to be digressing a bit to what I was talking about earlier. Athletics Kenya is currently holding a seminar with athletes in regards to mental health awareness. As we all know, it has been an emerging topic, really more spoken about nowadays than a while back. So let's listen in as Frederick Mookie tells us, or gives us a glimpse of what is happening. Mookie, kindly.
Other counties, Ngong did not really feel.
Good morning and welcome to this live broadcast. We're coming to you live from Ngong Hills. This is where the series of the Athletics Kenya seminar has just begun here in Ngong before it heads to Machakos tomorrow and across the country, as we'll be expecting close to athletes from this. Today's event is athletes drawn from the Nairobi region, where the seminar is going to discuss about key issues that has affected athletes, especially during the 2021 season, including mental health awareness, doping, and so many issues. But we're going to discuss a lot about what will be happening here today with Athletics Kenya executive member, that is Barnabas Korir, who doubles to be the chairman of Nairobi region. He's going to tell us about what the key highlights of this series of seminar. Welcome, Korir. Maybe just give us a glimpse of what is happening here today.
This morning we have the seminar. We normally have it when it's in a year, but as a result of what happened to Agnes Hirong, we decided now to go back to the athletes and ask them. We have had several seminars in the last 5 years, and we have not seen the concrete results from the athletes. Maybe we need to ask them to tell us exactly what we need to do so that we can assist them, because normally we invite professionals especially for doping, for finance, for KRS. But now, what we do as a federation, as executive, is to go to them and ask them what is ailing them. Because we immediately after the passing of Tirok, there are so many issues that came out that we realized some of the vulnerable athletes in the society, they need help. So we need now to talk to them. We have given also hotlines that they can reach us out. We have been actually solving those problems now. Most of them, those who are affected, both men and women, have come out and explained exactly what has been happening to them. Yesterday we had even a 6-hour discussion with several families, and we sorted them out. So this is what we want. We want them now to come out clearly and tell us what do we do so that we can support them, the government can support them, the county government can come on board. And then we talk also to the coaches, how do they relate to these athletes? Are they able to discuss? We have young athletes under 18. Where does the line between AK and the families come in? How do we handle those young athletes? Because you find that under 20 athletes, girls, when the moment they run good, you find that they get married. Is it the right time that those young girls can get married? How do you assist them so that they can avoid such? And then we have to ask them to deviate from the issues of getting married before. even their competition is over before their programs. So we need to, there are so many other things that we need to talk to them about the social life. There's something, there's a missing link with the athletes, because the missing link is this, you know, an athlete comes from nowhere, of course has been training, wins a championship, gets a lot of money, but there's no education in between on how to handle themselves, how to handle the, you know, the name they have received now, you know, the media and everything. How do they handle the issue of finance when they get a lot of money? So that now we engage the athlete, we engage the coach, we engage also the family, so that now this athlete will be the center of attention for everybody and to ensure they get correct advice so that they can continue their program.
Would you say it has come at the right time, or it's something that we should have seen before the start of the year, the start of the season maybe?
You know, it is very difficult to say it came at the right time, because we realized that they needed support 5 years ago, and we have had seminars every single year to discuss with them what support they require. But as a result of what has happened, especially the brutal murder of Agnes, it brought now everyone's attention to try to understand exactly, could there be a very serious undercurrent within this athlete? What is happening? So this is actually the right moment to address this issue before the championship. Now, the information that we are going to give them, or they pass on to us so that we can have a discussion with the national government, is going to assist them. And I think this is the right moment also to receive the information, and they will understand exactly what needs to be done for their protection.
Just give a hand. Maybe you can just give us a glimpse of the key highlights of the discussion here, apart from mental health awareness, maybe, or it's an open session. You can substantiate further about that.
So we decided to have an open session, because we did not want to give them the ideas of what we need to do. But we gave them the direction that we would like to do, and we gave them the overall picture of what the discussion should be. But we explained to them clearly that we need them now, because they know what is hailing them. The person who wears the shoe knows where it hurts, it pinches. So they are the ones now to tell us exactly, despite all the seminars we have had, because most of them have been there. You know, how come that most of the issues that we have discussed has not been implemented by them? So let them now have a discussion. Tell us exactly, within that paradigm of the discussion, not going outside what we want to discuss here. Then now they can tell us exactly what is wrong and what we need to do. The relationship between athletes and Athletes Kenya, we need to understand so that we can service them better. We need also to understand the roles themselves they have to play, their own integrity, the way they handle themselves, the role of social media, how we engage themselves within the social media, because most of it, 80% of where the discussion is negative, and it's negative against themselves and against their coaches. And then you find even some of them, sometimes they write things in the social media that even attacks their own athletes against athletes from other countries. So we need to tell them about what they should actually be responsible for, what they should write and what they should not write.
Thank you so much. That has been one of the Athletics Kenya officials who is just given us a glimpse of what we'll be expecting in these seminars. And I'll be also having a word with 5,000 meters world champion Helen Obiri. She's going to tell us maybe Helen Obiri, welcome to this live broadcast. First, tell us maybe your presence here today.
Sasa tumekuja hapa kuongea story ambayo imehusu kimbia, sababu tumeona athletes wana face a lot of challenges ambayo tuwezi tukasema. So ikiendelea ni vyema ikileta kila counties at least waweze kutufundisha na kutuelimisha ili tujue nini tunafaa kufanya katika maisha yetu.
Labda hemu tueleze kuna matatizo yapi ambayo nyinyi hupitia kama wanariadha, na labda mengine huwa mnaogopa kuyasema.
Let me say, like, ukiwa girl child ama boy child, kuna a lot of domestic violence in our homes, but huwezi ukapata mtu ambaye unamweleza vyema akuelewe. So unapata mtu ananyamazia story yenye ako nayo kwa mwili, awezi akashia to somebody ili mtu aweze akamsaidia. Na for example, unaweza ukapata like kuna training for youths. So unapata training camp for youths, unapata mtu ameweka, amejifanya ni coach, alafu ameweka the only ladies. So unapata wasichana wakikimbia, kuna venye wanatumika vibaya katika maisha yao. So ukipata akifika seniors, utapata atakimbia vizuri, sababu chini akupata msingi bora, sababu ametumika sana. So ataweza kuprogress vizuri na kariera yake.
Labda tunajua wewe ni mwanariadha tajika na umebobea katika masuala ya riadha. Labda hakuna wanariadha ambao wachipukizi ama marafiki ambao washakuja kwako labda wakaelezea masaibu ambayo wanapitia labda?
Yes, tuko na wengine ambao ni juniors ambao wanakuja wanakuambia fulani amenieleza hivi ama fulani katika ndoa yangu ni kwa. So sometimes we try our best to advise them what next to do. Sometimes mtu anasakafika na sema nimelemewa na maisha, I want to quit training so that I can start another career. So kwa tunawaeleza ni vyema waendelee na mazoezi sababu now tunawaleta kutoka training camps, maybe sometimes you can host kama unaweza. Yes.
Na labda unafikiria ni vema kuwa na mafunzo kama haya kila wakati ama ni manake tunaona kwamba yanaandaliwa msimu kuja kukamilika labda?
Okay, nimeshukuru sana Hekei sababu let me say like kwa meleta late sababu history ya Trop ndio imefanya at least vitu mingi ionekane venye zilikuwa zimefinyiliwa. I cannot say it's only Trop. Tumekuwa na a lot of ladies, a lot of poacher ndio wanasava. So Hekei tunawashukuru sababu wamefanya vyema ikianza na tunawaomba waendelee katika at least weke like every 6 months we have a talk. Every 6 months we have a talk so that issues yenye tuna face sinaweza come up ama sometimes na mtu anafaa anatarajia kufanya kitu mbaya. So tukiwa na nini kama hii unapata ile kitu ulikuwa unafikiria kufanya imetoka kwa akili yako. Yes.
And maybe tell us about the season. Imekuwaje? How has been the season for you?
Season yangu imekuwa ni vyema sababu hii ni mwaka ilikuwa ya COVID from last year tukua na so many races. So at least wewe ukipata race sababu hatukuwa tumejua kama Olympics itafanyika ama nini itafanyika. So for us kukimbia fanya nimekimbia season na sana nikashukuru Mungu sababu sikuwa najua nitakimbia hivyo. So season yangu ilikuwa mzuri. So for next I'm planning to go to races from next year. Yes.
Ada, mipango yako sasa hivi sasa maybe what are you focusing on now?
Kwa saa hii niko like build up sababu ukiwa unaendelea road races unafaa kufanya build up vizuri. So for now ili after Tokyo ni rest kidogo, from then kaanza build up. So from build up I'm going to sit down with my coach and with my manager to see what next for me. Yes.
Wish you all the best.
Thank you
so much. That has been Helen Obiri, the current 5000 meters world champion, and it is just close to 200 athletes who are just taking part in this one-day seminar that will be heading next to Machakos. And I'll be also having a word with one of the juniors who is also taking part in this seminar. Maybe just introduce yourself, then tell us maybe your presence here today.
I'm a marathoner, and I'm a world champion.
Individuals. So you never know what someone or a man or a lady what she is facing. So for us, I think in this seminar we will talk so that we can see if the Athletics Kenya will help us, and also we help us. We help ourselves. We support other people as athletes. I think we will go well in life.
Maybe as athletes, do you normally have meetings or do you discuss about challenges that each other face maybe on day-to-day activities?
I can say we only have seminars for doping, but this is the Athletics Kenya Federation have started to form these seminars to teach on how we can live. Because in this in this life of nowadays, everybody things are happening and it's happened. So I think we can stop that, those things. And we have to end these things of gender. Yeah.
Maybe you won the 2021 Boston Marathon. Maybe you can tell us how the season has been for you.
It was not Boston, it was a Chicago Marathon. And I was going there to win.
What does it tell you?
Because I had injuries before and I didn't make, so I came back and tried to my train well so that I can go there and win. Yeah.
And maybe what are you focusing on now for the new season? What are your targets?
For now, I'm waiting for my manager to sit down. Then we see for, let's say, for next year. We see some races I can run. And then I think I will do well.
Yeah. Wish you the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. That has been Ruth Chepngetich. She recently won the Chicago Marathon. And let me just finalize with a word with one of the coaches, Coach Kibwa, a veteran athletics coach who has been in athletics for quite some time now. And he's going to tell us, maybe give us a glimpse of his presence here today and what he thinks about this seminar. Coach Kibwa, welcome to this live broadcast. Maybe just give us an update of what is happening here today.
Thank you very much. Athletic Kenya has seen that we need to talk to whole athletes in this Republic of Kenya to tell us where we are heading wrong and where they are going wrong also. This is good. We must always, in a year, our athletes always, we meet, we call in Eldoret or Nairobi to talk to them. But this time, athletes have decided to call everybody, athletes, in where they are training. Like here now, where in Ngong, there are so many people who are training in Ngong. All of them
why
are here.
We
want to talk to them. They talk to us, and we listen to what they want us to provide. This affiliation.
Maybe you've been a coach for quite some time. Maybe you can tell us whether there are any challenges who have approached you to share some challenges they have faced and how you dealt with it.
For sure, there are so many challenges, as you know. A human being has a lot of challenges, but that challenge is now we are coming closer to the athlete, to their families, so that we know much about what they are doing down there. Also, we have come here to meet with coaches and those who have not attended the course, so that we can give them that opportunity of being a coach. So we are here and we want to analyze all the coaches and the athlete to be together. So this is why we are here today.
Maybe what's your advice to the young athletes and to the veteran athletes who have been in this career for quite some time?
That is good. That is a very good question. We are here so that we talk to the athlete to know their problem, and then after knowing the problem, to be good listeners also. They should listen to those coaches who have attended course, and they are the ones who can drive our life and also the performance of the country. So we are here to put them, all of them together, and they know if there is anything, we are our fathers to come up and tell us where we are going wrong, so that we can analyze and we put them together, so that progression will come, their life will be okay. And when they see the way they can improve themselves and their then it will be good, and they will, that is good for them. So we want to give, to tell them that we are available, we are ready to assist each other and also to assist us. Yes.
Coach, we wish to be a successful one. Thank you so much for the interview. Well, it is just a day one of a series of Athletes Kenya Athletes Seminar that has just begun in and Gong Hills, and it will be heading to Machakos tomorrow before going to Embu. And it is just a seminar that is bringing together athletes drawn from different training camps.
Well, thank you very much, Frederick Mwoki, for that, and of course for a more comprehensive report. Once again, remember to stay tuned into our subsequent bulletins, 1 p.m., 7 p.m. at night, Darubini and Prime Edition later on tonight at 9 p.m. Mental health, a huge issue in sports lately. Of course, we saw a couple of athletes withdrawing from different sports in the Olympics as well as other competitions this year and last year due to that. More to follow once again in our subsequent bulletins. Now, Francis Mutuku, as we finally wind up, maybe ask, because we'll be talking about, oh, what are we going to do for these elections? Who is going to be vying for this election? Will this party be able to vote and whatnot? But what can you say is the standard that the current office wants to, you know, leave behind as a legacy when it comes to electoral matters? Because, come on, every Kenyan knows the issues you have with leadership, with elections, with, you know, all that. So maybe for a sports federation such as yourself that works with literally all the other sports federations in the country, being NOC, what's the standard of the electoral processes that you want to leave in sport and in Kenya generally?
Thank you. We were very well guided with the challenges which were there in 2017. And in view of this, we presented to the General Assembly last year the register of membership, because register of membership is everything, because that's where you know who is going to vote, who is not going to vote. And we are happy that the register was adopted. And as we go to elections, we are clear who is a member of the National Olympic Committee, who can vote and who cannot vote. Mm-hmm. We are also very happy that there are very many people willing to come and serve. Obviously, I would like to believe that tells of how much the transformation has been from one of the organizations which people would want to keep off to one which everybody wants to be associated with. And we have very, very many people are interested in serving in different capacities. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the voters will have a very good opportunity to pick out the best in terms of the women and men who will be able to continue the transformation process of the National Olympic Committee. Olympics has three critical values. The first one is respect. The second one is friendship. Mm-hmm. And the third one is excellence. Mm-hmm. If we abide by those values, we believe this election will be very different from every other election. We'll be able to set the standards that if you are vying for the same position as I'm vying, we allow the voters to decide who they feel can serve best. If you have voted and I'm not voted, then since I'd already had expressed a wish, it means that I'm also available to serve. It means you have one more companion to serve with, because the sports fraternity is small, the work is a lot. Mm-hmm. Even the people who not make it to be elected with the executive, there are very many opportunities in which they can be able to serve within the Olympic and Commonwealth movement. Mm-hmm. And that's what we are looking forward to, that the 9th will be a turning point in terms of management of election. People will be elected, those who will be ready to serve very well, those who will lose will be ready to serve and support those who will have done it. Mm-hmm. For us, we are looking forward to a successful transition, whether it's the same team which will come or a new team. Mm-hmm. For us, it's very critical that we transition very well so that we can put sport to another great level.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Well said. Couldn't have put it any better myself. And really, we wish you all the best as we organize that election. And we do hope that, as you said, we're going to have clean and fair elections. Something different from what we're used to in this country, really. Thank you very much, Francis Mutuku, for your time. And I'm sure we shall be engaging yourself and NOC once again as we embark on preparations for the Commonwealth Games, which will be held in Birmingham 2022, starting 28th July till 8th of August. Well, that brings us to the end of the first segment on today's edition of Sports Check. But don't go too far. We're going to be back shortly with the second segment. See you later.
music do you do?
I do Afro R&B music.
According to Jackie Maribe then, it is that Eric Omondi is a deadbeat dad. He hasn't been present in the kids' life. There was also Jamal and the wives, as well as Nganga, Lillian, with Governor Mutua. I mean, yani relationships, exes, I mwezi awataki mchezo.
Another female artist lined up to perform was Nikita Kering. Miss Nikita's performance prepared the stage for Soul Generation signee Nviri the Storyteller.
Witness in me hitmaker Etana eventually stepped on stage and gave the revelers a beautiful performance.
Jasiri kama nyinyi mnaogopa kufanya mazam kembe.
Mimi naonelea tafute maarifa mengine kabla hatujajuta.
Upatie nafasi angalau niambie ukweli, lakini kila kukicha uongo wako wazidi kimo tu.
Dewe kwa wapi mzee? Ama ona hapa pakufai.
Let me tell you this. If you can't take care of my daughters, you will never see them again.
I am the wife of Alejandro's son, Roman. And I demand that your daughter leave my husband alone.
She married you because she wants to get even with you.
Your wife went to my ranch last night to demand that Diana stay away from you.
The Amazons.
Log on to the KBC website at www.kbc.co.ke to get the latest breaking news, entertainment, sports, politics, lifestyle or business trends from Kenya and around the world. Never miss new episodes from your favorite TV shows, reruns and movies. Just stream online or watch live on your YouTube channel at KBC Channel 1 TV shows for the day's biggest stories, trustworthy news and family entertainment. Log on to KBC Channel 1. Watch what you want anytime, anywhere.
Thought it was forever. Said that to love me, that would be for never.
Turn up the radio and turn up the music.
Tell me something, are you in all or nothing? Tell me something, are you in all or nothing?
Afro R&B music.
According to Jackie Maribe then, it is that Eric Omondi is a deadbeat dad. He hasn't been present in the kids' life. There was also Jamal and the wives. as well as Nganga, Lillian, with Governor Mutua. I mean, yani relationship exes, hii mwezi awataki mchezo.
Another female artist lined up to perform was Nikita Kering. Miss Nikita's performance prepared the stage for Soul Generation signing Viri the Storyteller.
Witness in me, hitmaker Etana eventually stepped on stage and gave the revelers a beautiful performance.
Welcome back to the second segment of today's edition of Sports Check, where we shall be talking about football development in the country, which is basically also the state of football in the country, which is we're going to be discussing and commending those who have been taking the front seat in promoting football in the country, and also the Kenya Premier League, that is the FKF Premier League, as well as looking at the CAF Champions League, in which Vihiga Queens are representing Kenya in Egypt. And to discuss that, of course, that during the football development bait, to discuss that is sports journalist and analyst Greg Mulemi. Greg Mulemi. And also in studio, Bramwell Karamoja, who is one of the stakeholders when it comes to promoting football. And he does that through the Karamoja Super Cup. He is a former footballer, and he shall be telling us more about that as we discuss what we have been doing as a country in promoting football among our youths, our youngsters, and also the senior teams. Thank you very much, guys, for joining us here in studio.
Thank you.
And maybe if you allow me, we can start with you, Bramwell. Mm-hmm. You can just, before we get into all the details about football in Kenya, maybe you can tell us about the Karamoja Super Cup, really, and what inspired you to, you know, start it, found it.
Thank you so much, Munga. My name is Bramwell Karamoja, a former footballer. I've played in the National Super League for Ngara Youth Pelico. I've played in the Kenyan Premier League for Gor Mahia FC. That was in 2006 up until 2019, before I went to Dubai to look for a proper job, because basically at that time football was not paying. Football doesn't still pay until now. So my family, I had pressure from my family to look for a proper job to sustain me. So I went to Dubai, but while in Dubai, I got a job, but that is not what I wanted to do, because all my life I've known football. I've played football from a very tender age. So while in Dubai, I just told myself, like, no, I have to go back in Kenya and try and, you know, do what I like. Mm-hmm. So I stayed in Dubai for 8 years until we started an initiative called Jazza Study. Mm-hmm. Initiative, which basically is all about trying to bring back the fans to the stadium to support their teams whenever they are playing. It beats logic when you go to the bars, to the clubs here. The bar is full. People are watching Man U versus Arsenal. But if you go to Kasarani, Kariobangi Sharks versus Tusker, you hardly find 100 people. Sports is the only industry that until now I've never understood. When they say, when there was COVID, they said that we need to have social distancing. We've been having that for more than a decade now. So we came up with a few friends of ours and decided, you know, we need to change this narrative. We need to bring back people in the stadium. That is when we started the Jazza Star Initiative. So that is what brought me back in the country. Mm-hmm. So while at it, I looked around and said, I was organizing tournaments abroad. I was organizing an African football extravaganza in Dubai. So I said, I can replicate that in Kenya, because I had started partnering with the international brands. So I said, if I come back and do that here, I think I can become someone. Yeah, so that is how I started organizing tournaments, and that is how the Karamoja Super Cup started. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, Greg, really, you've been even commentating, besides analyzing, you've been commentating football in the country for a while now. And can you say, besides the COVID-19 period, whereby stadia were banned, you could not access stadia as spectators, but can you say that that culture of actually going to the stadium to watch matches, can you say that we are actually doing well at it? Because what he said is actually true, that you'll find entertainment joints filled with people watching an international game, but where is the energy when it comes to local leagues? Is that the case?
What Bram is saying is very true. I remember when Jazz Study officially launched, it was at Camp Toyoyo. Mm-hmm. Kariobangi Sharks versus Wazito.
Yes.
I think that was the match. And it really rained on that day, but you could see what people really wanted. The stadium was full. I think the game ended 2-1 in favor of... 4-0 in favor of
Sharks.
Yeah, yeah. And Kapaito, that's when we started knowing Kapaito. Yes, Kapaito. And that shows you that people really want to watch soccer. And I can always tell you that we've marketed our soccer very poorly, and it's really affecting the game. You can see a decade ago, Sofapaka versus FC Leopards could draw up to 10,000 fans, but right now barely 200 people go watch that match. Mm-hmm. Gor Mahia is playing Kenya Police at Kasarani last weekend, and barely 1,000 people are attending the match. So it shows you that we've really deteriorated in terms of how we market our game, bringing fans back to the stadium. I remember when Tusker were sponsoring the Kenya Premier League, then they really did a lot in marketing, mm-hmm. and you could see there was a change. That's what we are missing. There's a very, very big delink between the league and the fans. We only depend on social media updates.
Okay. Now, the next question is posed to the both of you. Maybe Greg, you can continue, and then Bramwell will tell us that later. Will tell us his take on that, because we've been talking about promoting football, the uptake of football amongst fans going to the stadium. But do you think it's time we changed our strategy a bit? Because recently we've had... basically more than 50% of the matches being played around maybe Nairobi and its environs, whereby we used to expect that people will at least, as you say, 10,000 people will attend a Gor Mahia match at Kasarani or Nyayo or even Toyoyo or Ruaraka where Tusker plays. But then again, do you think we are concentrating too much on Nairobi when I think actually outside of Nairobi most people are actually watching local football than in Nairobi? You remember, first of all, this last weekend when the stadium ban was lifted, there was a game, was it Kakamega
Homeboys versus Stadium?
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah,
that was, and you could actually see guys actually came out to watch that match. So is it that we are concentrating, or, you know, we keep talking about football in Nairobi, since, you know, Is that the case, really? Should we be more open to actually evaluating how football fans are appreciating the game outside of Nairobi in the counties?
Definitely. Mm-hmm. And it all boils down to whatever we want heading forward. You look at, let's say, Nairobi has a lot of teams playing in the FKF Premier League, and most of these teams are, some of them are very corporate teams who, after all, fans are not an issue to them. But you find that most of these community clubs come from up country. Look at Kakamega Homeboys, look at the likes of the Zukericho, Vihiga Bullets, for that matter. These are teams that are associated with the society, and when they do that, people have a feeling of what they want from the team. They demand to watch the team. They feel that they are part of the team, and that's what we are missing in Nairobi. You know, in Nairobi, everyone, like, if I want to watch football, I can always do some other things. For marketing purposes, I think that's where these clubs have actually gone wrong totally. Because you look at, there's a Division One club called Kibera United, and when they play Gogo United, mm-hmm. it's full to capacity. Exactly. Mm-hmm. That should tell you that there is a very, very, very huge difference between how we market our game, how do we take it to the fans. And look at the likes of, when I was commentating the National Super League, that was two seasons ago, there was a derby between Kangemi United and Kibera United, Kibera Black mm-hmm. Stars. That game used to be full. There's a day I did a post-match interview with the former Kibera Black Stars coach, that was Solo, who's now at KCB. Mm-hmm. the fans were almost killing me because they were demanding for answers, and when you and we were live on TV, so you can feel that they associated themselves with the club. But look at the likes of FC Lepers Gombe, what remained of them, Banters and all that.
Okay, that is indeed true. And maybe you take on that, because what he said is true. Even NSL matches actually pull a bigger crowd than FKF Premier League matches. We had even the Super 8 League used to pull extreme. More.
Yes. Exactly. When Costas played Kangemi.
You know, the problems are, we can't talk about the problems. Mm-hmm. I think for me, it's about the structure. Greg has talked about most of the teams being in Nairobi. You find a team like Bandari plays a match in Nairobi today, goes back in Mombasa, comes back for another match. For me, I think our structure is wrong. Mm-hmm. There's a time, I normally have a program called Chapiane, which is a local football show. Mm-hmm. We discussed this, the marketing aspect, what can we do to change this? And I think the biggest letdown for me is the structure. The way the league is structured does not allow for teams. Long time ago, we had teams like Eldoret, KCC, we had the Motcoms, we had the Rivertechs, the Alaskans. Mm-hmm. Where are they? So I think for me, the first thing we need to do, we need to reinvent the wheel. Get the structure right. Now we have the counties, it's even easier. Let every county produce a team. And you know, we have 47 counties, right? Well, you can't have a team from the 47 counties because you'll have a very big league. So other counties can merge. Yeah. We have a county like Kiambu can merge with Nairobi.
You see? Can have more tiers of football.
Yes. So once we merge, once we have football being played in counties, we'll have that rivalry. Can you imagine Kakamega County going to play Kisumu County in a Kenyan Premier League match at Buhungu Stadium? Mm-hmm. You'll have a capacity crowd.
Full.
Nairobi County is playing Mombasa County in Mombasa. We'll have a capacity crowd. So for me, I think we have a problem with our structure. I don't know how we'll do it. In Brazil, I think it's played that way. Mm-hmm. The Brazilian league is played in provinces.
Regions, yeah.
In regions. So if we can adapt that, I think that can save the situation. Mm-hmm. Marketing is neither here nor there because everyone blames each other. Mm-hmm. The federation will blame the teams will blame the fans. So we'll never finish this conversation. We'll talk about marketing, I think, when we come to the segment when we'll be talking about the Karamoja Super Cup. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you how we can channel it to the Premier League.
Okay. And something interesting is here, because we've talked about playing, having all these teams, yes. We can have different tiers. We can have more tiers of football.
Yeah.
FKF Premier League can be on top, NSL. We can have more divisions, you know.
Yeah.
We all know how the promotion and relegation process works.
Yeah.
But then again, are we ready for that, considering, you know, there are many issues here, really. First of all, infrastructure, sports infrastructure.
You mean the stadium?
Exactly. That's what I mean. So where are we supposed to be playing this game?
We have stadium. We have stadia. You know this narrative of there's no infrastructure. Mm-hmm. We're in Africa. Yeah. I'll give you an example of a country like the USA. We have colleges that have better facilities than this country here. We can borrow that. We have schools that have very proper fields. Mm-hmm. Even better than the Kamtoyoyos and the Ruarakas. If you go to Kakamega High School, they have two proper fields that you can play at Kenyan
Kisi High School.
Kisi High School. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We have Musingu High School.
Braeburn.
We have Kitale Day, yeah. St. Anthony's. You know, all those things, we can't, there's no lack of structure. Mm-hmm. It's just, I think we're just disorganized.
Just disorganized.
Yeah. Yeah. I was told to that, do we really need stadiums? How big is Craven Cottage? Mm-hmm. How big is the Brighton?
St. Mary's.
Yes, so how big is St. Mary's?
Is it about the size or also the quality?
People, because
let's
when
be
you talk
honest,
about
if we can't host even, yeah. let's say, continental matches or international matches, which is a huge, it's huge for development of football, because the more investment is pumped into the country whenever it hosts such a, you know, mm-hmm. an international showpiece, it also counts for that. So maybe are these stadiums quality? We do have
how
stadiums.
How many stadiums
are
do we
they
need?
Quality?
How many stadiums do we need to host an international match?
Mm-hmm.
In this country. Mm-hmm. I don't think we need more than 4 stadiums.
No, we don't need more.
We already have Kasarani. Just upgrade it. We already have Nyayo Stadium. Mm-hmm. Upgrade it. We have Kisumu, yeah. right now. It's an yeah. international stadium,
and
according
is coming up
to our standard,
it's
standards.
An international. Yeah. Okay.
We have Buhungu Stadium. Yeah. Those are already 4. What happened to Kipchoge in Eldoret?
Yeah.
We don't know. But I'm talking about the Kenyan Premier League. I think the Kenyan Premier League, in its current status, can be played even in schools. Because Kamtoyo is not any better. Two seasons back, we were playing the Kenyan Premier League at Camp Toyo. No sitting, no nothing, no toilets. At least in schools, you're guaranteed that you'll get a toilet. Yeah. So I think we can work with the resources we have. This is what we have as we plan for better days in future. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you agree with that, or do you think we try too much to, let's say, save face by, you know, holding our matches in all this? We all know that we can name them, mm-hmm. you know, Kwa Mkono, number of... do you think that we try so hard to save face?
Why are we trying to elevate ourselves to, let's say, a first-class status when we are not even yet at the third phase? Mm-hmm. That's where the problem begins. Mm-hmm. We had games played at the Annex last season, and it was very, very brilliant. Guys were like, this place can actually work for us.
Yeah.
And you can see, like on Saturday, Bidco was playing Madari at the Annex, and inside the main stadium, Police was playing Gor Mahia. And each went concurrently well, simultaneously, without any problem. That shows you that when we plan well, it's talked about Kakamega High School, why not have like the likes of Vihiga play there? Why are we forcing guys to play at Toyo, at Ruaraka? We witnessed the WPL Super Cup yesterday, the Utali ground. It's already worn out. Mm-hmm. Why are we forcing our players to play there? One, injuries, poor quality of football, poor production for TV and everyone else, proximity, all these things. When we don't look at them critically, then it becomes a problem. And I think that's why mm-hmm. even the likes of Bram, when they come up, his tournament is played at Samitsi Primary Grounds. And I can see a lot of people go attend that tournament, and the pitch and the surface is very, 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 very good for football. Why are we complicating matters when we don't have the resources? That is the problem we have.
You're drinking champagne on a beer budget.
Oh, no.
Isn't it a conversation that requires a lot of time? And since we're talking about the development of football in the country, let's at least try to focus at the moment, because of time, at the moment, on the positives. For example, the CAF Champions League, whereby, you know, it's the inaugural tournament, but from the word go, we it's something we've seen that our women in football are performing quite exemplary, if you're being honest. Vihiga Queens played its first match in the CAF Women's Champions League, beating Mamelodi Sundowns. I think we can talk about that, but just a bit, if my producer can kindly play us the highlights of that. Vihiga Queens, or rather we can just have a view as we discuss this, really. Vihiga Queens versus Mamelodi Sundowns. Just
the likes of Cynthia Shiluaso.
We have
the likes of Akida, the first African to score a hat-trick in the Champions League.
Yeah.
And that shows you that there's better talent out here if it's well-nurtured. But it was really sad, the FKF, two Africa women, Africa Cup of Nations, and they are en route to qualifying. And if they beat Uganda right now, they'll be qualifying for the third in a span of 7 years. That shows you that there's huge progress in this. But then what do? We need just to make sure that we attract sponsors, attract corporates to come and sponsor these ladies. We talked about the Women World Cup 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
What was the viewership in the final? 1 billion.
1.2 actually.
1.2 billion. Mm-hmm. That shows you that the women game is being watched everywhere. And I know you're an Arsenal fan. When Arsenal is beaten, I know Arsenal ladies will always win, and you'll always share that on social media. So that shows you that these things, we just need just to find the right boxes and tick them.
And it's going to work, really. Yeah. Okay, now just kindly, we're going to be digressing a bit. We shall be taking the viewers to Mombasa for the Sport Women and Engineer Summit, where our colleague O'Brien Kimani is on standby to update us on what's happening over there. So kindly, let's listen into that.
Well, thank you very much, Richard Monga, back there in the broadcasting house. We are here at the Pride Inn here in Mombasa. We are camping for the next 5 days as we listen to engineers discuss the future of our economy. And of course, this is the 28th Institution of Engineers of Kenya conference taking place here in Mombasa. And the theme for this year is Engineers Accelerating Sustainable Economic Development. Today there was a meeting, a very interesting one, of women engineers. About 250 of them were rocked up here in this room, and they were conversing various issues on how to tip more women to join the engineering fraternity, bearing in mind that less than 7% or less than 10% of women engineer or engineers in Kenya are women. Joining us now is the Engineers Board of Kenya registrar. This is Engineer Margaret Ogai, as well as Engineer Jilo. The conversation that we are going to have is how to encourage more women to join the engineering fraternity. Thank you very much, much indeed, Margaret. You had the conversation here about how to mainstream more women to join the engineering fraternity. Why do we have such a small number of women joining engineering?
Thank you very much, O'Brien. I really appreciate that question. Yes, currently we only have 7%, as you see it, and it is historical and cultural. When we were young as girls, very few girls were taking science subjects, and it was discouragement that mathematics is hard. So I think a lot of women did not have role models to start doing engineering. I think as we've gone on, fortunately with our new constitution, we're encouraging more and more women to take up any field that they have interest and competences and intellectual capacity. And we have seen an increase, an upsurge in the numbers of engineers, and we continue to encourage girls and women that this is a very fulfilling career. It is just like any other, and it's also an economic issue. When you don't take up the field of engineering, then you also do not participate in the economy that there is in construction industry. And you know that we are already investing over 500 billion every year in construction as a government. So we are asking all our girls and our ladies and our women, please take up this. And we also need you in this area. Because we need diversity in the decision making that we are making. How do we transport you? What's your energy that you need in your homes? So we are asking all our girls, our ladies, we are here for you. And as an engineers board, we are also trying to encourage and will support you through mentorships and partnering with the Institution of Engineers of Kenya. We believe the numbers will go up. Thank you.
Very well. And the other question is, I mean, as engineer or as a registrar of EBK, I mean, you would consider to be one of the topmost women engineers here in Kenya. Yes. Would you say engineering is friendly to women?
Yes, I would say, I think that comes down. I think we have had a big discussion, very interesting discussion there. It is not overt. There will be nothing that will stop you. If you're doing well in the, you know, in your academic studies and you come out to the field, I think there are no real obvious barriers. But as you start working, you go to the field. We don't have friendly and friendly environment. We never used to have even separate toilets for the ladies in the old days. So already that discourages you. When you're a nursing mother, you really do not want to be going to a field far away. And engineering involves both designing the office and going to the field. Mm-hmm. So because of that, you find many the young nursing mothers choose then not to be doing, to work in the office, to do design work. But it doesn't give you a full roundedness as an engineer. Mm-hmm. So those are the things, and I don't think it is like it is discrimination per se. But when you stop now taking up some certain roles and responsibilities, you'll find that even your career gets affected. So those are the things we are looking at. How do we make it easier for the women so that they can also get fulfillment? And after all, issues of pregnancy and motherhood are for a very short period.
Let's also get to hear from Madam Jilo. I mean, don't go away. I'll just move in here. Jilo, you're from the coast, and when you look at the number of women engineers, from the coast, the number is very, very small, actually. As an engineer, what are you doing to chaperone more young women to join the engineering sector?
Okay, thank you for that question. Yes, I agree with you. From coast, we have very few lady engineers, and one of them is lack of role models, and another area is poverty. So what we are doing, we have some role models that have come up, and we also call in speakers to come and give a talk to these girls in school, and just to encourage them and let them know that they can make it even as girls. And we also have systems in place where the poor but bright students are supported in one way or the other. We have come in even as IEK. We pay school fees for those who are needy, and we encourage them. And the challenge is that it's very hard to get them, even when we lower the, or when we put the bar so that we can accommodate girls. It's very difficult to get them. So that's the challenge we are having in Coast, but we will keep on encouraging them. Yes.
What would you identify as one of their biggest challenges? I mean, because, you know, you have lowered, you know, the what you would call the max, you know, to joining the field for women, but you still have challenges of girls, you know, wanting to join the field. What would you say is the biggest impediment?
Just like my colleague, Engineer Margaret Ogai, has said, culture. Because you'll find that when a family does not have enough money to support both girls and boys, they'll prefer taking boys to school and leave out the girls. So culture does not also encourage girls to go further. Even if it's you, the girl is bright, you'll find that the boys EPL prefer to do. The girls. Yes.
Engineer, before I let you go, as EBK, are you partnering with learning institutions and especially high schools and primary schools to start chaperoning young girls, you know, and showing them the importance of becoming engineers in the future?
Yes, thank you very much, O'Brien. Actually, first, we are partnering with the Institution of Engineers of Kenya, because they have a very vibrant capacity and mentorship chapter. So we want to partner with them, and through that we'll be able to reach out to schools, and we have done it. In the past, before COVID, our conference used to have a high school section where we'd actually take high school students and take them through at the region, in Coast region, and take them through all the different diverse fields of engineering. Going forward, we also have a program as EBK. We are starting with, I think, at the World Toilet Day, which is coming up on 19th of November. We are going to go to a primary school. Apart from assisting in terms of washing facilities, we are going to mentor the children who we are going to meet about what engineering is, so that they also get inspiration and different ideas.
Very good.
So, yes, thank you.
Engineer Gino, what is your message to the young ladies who are watching you?
Oh, the young ladies, I want to encourage them and tell them they can make it. We've gone ahead of them, and we're making the path smooth for them so they can make it.
Very well. Thank you so much indeed for your time.
Thank you.
Good luck and all the best in your deliberations.
Yes,
very well. Yes. Well, those are two... very soon. That's true. Those are some of the most qualified engineers, women engineers in Kenya, of course, having the conversation about how to encourage more young girls to become engineers, bearing in mind that only 7% of Kenyan engineers are women. How do you upscale that number? That is one of the conversations that is taking place here today. More than 250 women engineers are converged here to see how to induct more women into the engineering fraternity. And one of the questions that is being asked is, how do you break the tradition barriers that has been an impediment to more women joining this sector? Those are some of the conversations that we shall be having here. We're here for the next 5 days, so expect nothing but the best in terms of coverage. This is the 28th Institution of Kenya Engineers Conference taking place here in Mombasa. Back to you in studio.
Thank you very much, O'Brien Kimani. Of course, as you said, it's all about changing perceptions, encouraging younger girls not to be shy of indeed venturing into engineering. And in that same spirit, as we continue the conversation, as we talk about how we can also encourage more women to get into sports, to sports leadership, not only as players and whatnot. So back to what we were talking about, and we were talking about the CAF Women's Champions League, and after highlighting, or rather after seeing how they performed the 1-0 against Mamelodi Sundowns, hopefully they recover in the next game today. As we also, we had in the qualifiers, Vihiga Queens actually fell in the first game against the CBE of Ethiopia, but then again ended up winning, actually beating them in the final. So let's hope it's the same scenario with the CAF Women's Champions League. Now, in the same breath, since it's all about, I did realize that the interest really, not only in, you know, among the viewers,
viewers, even you guys are concentrating so much on the development of football amongst women. Which brings me to a question I had for you, Bramwell.
Yeah.
Since you're talking so passionately about that, in the development of women's football, mm-hmm. but in the Carabao, Karamoja Super Cup, of course the tournament, is it like so many other tournaments whereby we say we are holding tournaments to promote football, but then again, we only have, you know, boys competitions in that, or, you know, do you, you know, practice what you preach?
I practice what I preach, mm-hmm. and, when we started the Karamoja Super Cup in 2019, that was our first edition, we were testing the waters. So we only focused on the men's side of the game. Mm-hmm. But in the second edition, which was last year, we had eight women teams taking part. The winners were awarded, of course. Not only women football, we also had volleyball for women. Mm-hmm. And then now this year we are taking it now to the next level. Mm-hmm. We've increased the number of teams. The male will bring us 32 teams. The women will bring us half of that. So we are upgrading from 8. Now we are going to 16. And my vision for this tournament is to see women receiving the same prize money as their male counterparts. Because you see, in most competitions, the women are just given a thank you, goodbye. If there's any prize money, they're given 350,000 for 9 months, after playing for 9 months. This year, we're trying to see if we can bridge that gap. Of course, we're still looking for more corporate sponsorship, but as of now, we're saying this, that as much as we want to promote the boy child, we can't forget about the girl child, because as I've told you, I think our women have higher chances of even playing in the World Cup before their male counterparts do. Mm-hmm. So my vision in the next 5 years is that if the prize money for the winning male team is 1 million shillings, the women will get the same amount as winners. Mm-hmm. So to answer your question, yes, we are promoting both the men and the women football in equal measure. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, and in that same spirit, Greg, of course, we were talking about the marketing of the game, but do you think we're doing enough at the moment to market women's football? We're just talking about initiatives that are supposed to improve women's football, but are we doing enough in terms of marketing? Because when most people hear, let's say, like what he has said about prize money being the same, which really also leans onto the whole debate of equal pay for both men and women, but then again, you find that it's only the men's, you know, football that is, you know, marketed more. So do you think we've been taking, we've been implementing enough strategies to actually market the women's game?
Not yet. I think we've done maybe 20% of what we're supposed to do, because you look at whatever we have at the moment, results and players reporting to camp. That's all we have. We don't have these things that will make us, like you asked me, how many players from Gaspo does one person know? Mm-hmm. Not really many. And it all boils down also to these teams themselves. What are they doing to ensure that they market their product very well? Ulinzi Stars is a side that was started barely 2 years ago. And right now, everyone is talking about Ulinzi Stars because of what they've put to ensure that they market themselves to the world. And you can see it's bore fruits. Look at their performances, and that shows you that it also starts with the individuals themselves. How do you market yourself? You cannot say that you're a team and you don't even have a social media handle, or you don't even have a website that can update people on whatever is happening. Vihiga Queens, I wish them well in the SEKAFA, because they are a very, very brilliant side, very, very talented players. But then how do you launch a website two days to a tournament?
Okay, but in the same breath, really, to be a bit fair to them, from, you know, just saying, these are four-time Kenya champions. Yeah, just a thought. Yeah, you're talking about teams having their, you know, launching their websites and updating them, but we have federations who have not updated their websites for the last 5 years.
That is what I told you, Munga, when we started, that we can't start throwing, mm-hmm. We can't start tossing the coin around. Mm-hmm. What Greg is saying, right now social media is a very powerful tool. Mm-hmm. And if you come to the players individually, they can also market themselves individually. Look at the Harambee Stars players. You go to Kenneth Muguna's account, he's updated his workout today morning. Mm-hmm. He's updated his previous workout yesterday. What are our women doing? They're not doing anything. You go to social media, I only see Corazon, who is very Rachel Mwema. Yeah. I see Akida, and I see Nedi, yeah. And maybe Karimi.
Yeah.
The rest are nowhere to be seen. So I think it's high time we need to start taking social media marketing as a very powerful tool. Because you see, nowadays mainstream media, I mean, it's still mainstream, but very many people are on their phones. That is why even a corporation like KBC has to be on YouTube, has to be on Facebook, has to be on Twitter, and has to be on Instagram, because nowadays people don't have time to watch TV, mm-hmm. but they have time on their phones. People spend almost 60% of their time on social media than on mainstream media. So what we are saying is, let our women embrace technology, let them come up. We can promote them on our own handles. Greg has a good following on Facebook. I have a good following on Facebook. If you give me your account, I'll promote it. This in turn will turn maybe into customers, clients. There are so many people. You know, our ladies, we are very beautiful ladies in our women national team. We have products that can associate themselves with. If someone like Nedi sells Nivea to me, I'll drink it. Mm-hmm. I'll not even apply it on my body. I'll drink it. You see, so let's embrace technology. Let's start using social media because it's a very powerful tool.
Okay.
Yeah.
Greg, your 2 cents on in regards to that, and then we'll have Bramwell wind up with what we should expect at the Super Cup. But in regards to the marketing thing, your take on that, your 2 cents on that.
Really. First of all, I'll give FKF credit for ensuring that the league is consistent. It's where it's organized. We saw a couple of games being absconded last season. I hope that will not happen this season. I think maybe they're planned better. Mm-hmm. And we've always said that maybe a step forward is what we need, mm-hmm. not a stagnant step. And for the marketing purpose, I'll always challenge. Because all we know, most of this information, if I need any information about a team or a club, I'll rely on a set of fans who are really religiously following these teams, and that's not how it should be. Mm-hmm. So they should market themselves better, ensure that they give us what we need to consume, instead of this hullabaloo and sarcasm that we always see on social media about these players and everything. When you do the right things will always come to you.
Okay. Yeah. Now to Bramwell, in less than a minute, kindly, what do we expect? And you've had your say on the marketing issue, so now, in less than a minute, what do we expect from this year's Karamoja Super Cup?
We had a very successful launch last weekend, 30th of October. The amount of people who've shown support has been growing by the day. As I've told you, we've increased the number of teams to 32 this year, and that's the men football. Then the women football has gone up to 16. We have volleyball, both for men and women. We normally have also, this year we're going to have bullfighting. For the first time, we are trying to incorporate.
Think Omega, right?
Maybe we should have an eating competition since it's in Luyaland. Mm-hmm. But the stakes are higher this time. Of course, the prize money is going to double up mm-hmm. from last year. We're still trying to talk to a few partners here and there mm-hmm. to see where they can try and bridge the gap. But I can only tell people to expect a better tournament, a well-organized tournament, and a very big crowd this year, because last year we had crowds of between 10 to 15,000 at Samitsi grounds. Mm-hmm. I'm sure this year it's going to be bigger and better. Mm-hmm. So people should clear up their diaries, their calendars. The finals are going to be held on the 28th of December, which will be, I think, on a Tuesday at Samitsi grounds, Malava constituency, Kakamega County.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Bramwell Karamoja, and of course, Greg Mulemi. Always a pleasure. It's always good, of course, sitting and having conversations with people who are interested in the well-being of Kenyan sports, be it football, volleyball, rugby, either of them. And obviously, most of the sports leadership has called on to Kenyans really to give their opinions in regards to how sports is run in this country. So we are hoping that that's going to be a trend, and it's going to be the first step in changing and improving sports, the esports industry in the country. Well, that brings us to the end of today's edition of Sports Check. But don't go too far. Gladys Mungai is coming up next with Kurunzi and Tamrini. So do enjoy that. And, well, I'm Richard Munga. Have a good day.